been in a cave for 40 days with only a spark to light my way. I wanna give out, I wanna give in. This is our crime, this is our sin. But I still believe, I still believe. Through the pain and through the grief, through the lies, through the storms, through the cries and through the wars, oh, I still believe. These waves don't cover me. I'm turned and tossed upon the waves. When the darkness comes, I feel the grave. But I still believe, I still believe. Through the cold and through the heat, through the rain and through the tears, through the crowds and through the cheers, oh, I still believe. This road, I'll climb this hill upon my knees if I have to. I'll take my place upon this stage. I'll wait till the end of time for you like everybody else. Woo. afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to Branch Brothers. It's me, Seth. Let's get the call with Rick, my good friend and co-host, started. Oh, wait a minute. There we go. Yeah.
Hello?
Hello there.
So, how are we doing this fine Sunday afternoon?
Not gonna lie, I'm exhausted. I don't know if it's from last night or what, but I was like, I did not get to sleep until like, I think 1 in the morning. But, you know, it's, nonetheless, here we are. I still attended the church in person, and I'm still here to do this, so let's just rock.
All right, it's awesome to hear, man.
Yeah.
So, what are you covering for today?
Admittedly, because of how absolutely insane this past week was, I did not have the time to take notes on the Intercessor's Handbook for chapter 2 covering the Season of Warfare. So I'm just going to be covering some of what we did at Mass at the Lutheran Church today.
Okay, what did you do at Mass today?
The pastor did a sermon on like being wealthy in the physical and material sense of the word versus being wealthy in the spirit, and how we should put our trust in God rather than something as unpredictable and perishable as money. And as someone who has fucked around in the stock market and in crypto, I can tell you there is a great amount of wisdom in knowing that, yeah, fortunes can vanish in the blink of an eye, and that you shouldn't just be relying on money to solve all of your problems. It is a great problem solver. I'd be lying if I said otherwise, but it shouldn't be your only problem solver.
Of course. And conversely, I think the opposite can also be true, in the sense that, like, not to counter, but in the sense that, like, if you lose money, it's not a deal breaker, because you can always make more money. But what you can't make more of is time.
Yes, absolutely. And you know what's really funny about all this? Last night and the night prior, me and my cousin were actually watching Wolf of Wall Street of all movies, so the timing on this could not have been better. If you're not familiar with that movie, it's about a guy who got rich and famous doing really shady, underhanded shit, and the movie actually ends with him going to jail and then just realizing, wait a minute, I still have skills as like a salesman, and so he ends up doing like seminars while in prison and just kicking it back while in like a high class prison essentially. And it's like, well, yeah, that is unfortunately how the law works. It's like a spider's web. The flies get caught and the hornets go free. And you know, it kind of goes to show that even when we as people have the best intentions setting up society to protect, like, people from getting taken advantage of, no solution we have will ever be perfect. What did you want to cover, though?
Well, for today, I'm going to cover the Sacrament of Holy Order.
What's that one?
So basically, Holy Orders is what we can subclassify as one of the two sacraments of service, the other being matrimony. Matrimony, for those who don't know, is marriage. That's how it's officially classified within the church.
Yeah,
but Holy Orders is actually the process by which one becomes an ordained priest of the church.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I spent basically the last week reading on this stuff, and I'll just be going through my notes. Now, before I get started, I just want to share a couple quotes with St. Paul regarding this particular... Well, it's not specifically about the sacrament, but it's one of the many ways to sort of describe how it all works. So first, St. Paul says to disciple Timothy, "I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within you through the laying on of my hands. And if anyone aspires to the office of bishop, he desires a noble task. To Titus, he said, 'This is why I left you in Crete, that you amend what was defective and appoint presbyters in every town as I directed you.' The whole church is a priestly people. Through baptism, all the faithful share in the priesthood of Christ. This participation is called the common priesthood of the faithful. Based on this common priesthood, in order to its service, there exists another participation in the mission of Christ, the ministry conferred by the sacrament of holy orders, where the task is to serve in the name and in the person of Christ, the head, in the midst of the community. So basically the idea here is that when you are baptized, I've said this in the past, when you're baptized, you're anointed priest, prophet, and king. Upon baptism, you attain what's called a kingdomly priesthood. What that means is that as a layman, you are called to not only teach, spread the word of God to others, but more importantly, help to, like the prophets in the past, bring people back whenever they're lost. This is where the whole rebuking process comes into play. But the idea here is that it's actually kind of rooted in the original priesthood that kind of was started among the people of Israel before the Golden Calf Incident, where the head of every household, which was the father, was the priest of that household. Of course, after that incident, it was changed to just the Levites. But even the Levitical priesthood was only meant to be universal until the coming of Christ. After Christ made it so through baptism, we can all share in that priesthood role to some degree. But in regards to the other one...
I just wanted to elaborate on that, because that's actually not something exclusive to the Catholic Church. That every Protestant church I've attended that I've like asked about baptism, they say the same thing as well. The wording or the terms used might be a bit different, but essentially they believe the same thing, that when you become baptized and a part of God's kingdom, you may not be a pastor, quote-unquote, but you are still called as a Christian to act the part, essentially.
Yeah, I think in many ways, this new covenant that we're a part of is a... in many ways, new covenant is a fulfillment in the old. And this is probably one of the clearest examples of that, because, you know, I think God always intended to have a nation of priests, a nation of priestly people. That's what the people of Israel were supposed to be. But unfortunately, in many ways, they weren't. But through the second chance that we all have this time, we can do that. We can be that priestly people.
Right.
But only if we step up and answer that call.
Yeah, and you know, for a very, very long time, I had thought that, you know, as a layperson, you really should avoid trying to do things that the priests do. When I'm like, in some senses that's accurate, in others not so much. We are not meant to have a passive relationship with God, where we just go to church every Sunday, listen to what the pastor has to say, and then go home and go about our lives. We as Christians are meant to be the word. We are meant to live by example, essentially. And that's something that Paul talks about a lot in his letters. Unless you're that one church that was so out there that even the pagans are like, are these guys really who they say they are? I can't remember which letter or which church that was, but it got a good chuckle out of me. It's like, oh man, you guys need to get your stuff together.
Yep. Those things happen. Now, allow me to, where was I? Oh, here we go. The ministerial priesthood differs in essence from the common priesthood of the faithful because it confers the sacred power for the service of the faithful. The ordained ministers exercise their service for the people of God by teaching munus docendi, divine worship, munus liturgicum, and pastoral governance, munus regendi. Now, I do apologize if my Latin sounds a little blunt. Latin is not my first language, so I try to pronounce it to the best of my ability.
I mean, yeah, basically, it sounds like you at least try to study it. Like, you have a better grasp on it than most would.
Yeah, I mean, Latin is the language, because if you've ever studied the other ones, like Spanish, French, Italian, you know, I am of Puerto Rican descent, so I know a lot of Spanish, actually. By knowing the Romance languages, it helps to better understand Latin, because all those Roman languages spun off from Latin.
Yeah.
So it makes that a little bit easier. Now, where was that? Okay, here. Since the beginning, the ordained ministry has been conferred and exercised in three degrees, that of bishops, presbyters, and deacons. The ministries conferred by ordination are irreplaceable for the organic structure of the church. Without bishops, presbyters, and deacons, one cannot speak of the church. And this is quoting St. Ignatius of Antioch from a document called Ad Rome. So easily one of the oldest saints in our history. In fact, he is actually a grand disciple of, I believe, St. either St. Paul or St. John. I think it was John, actually.
What is the one grand disciple? Is that like a disciple of a disciple of a disciple?
Yeah, it's like a disciple of a disciple. You're 1 degree off. It's a disciple of a disciple. So,
gotcha.
The guy who mentored St. Ignatius was himself a disciple of St. John. And then that guy goes on to mentor St. Ignatius.
Yeah, it's interesting. I'm sorry, I'm just kind of having a realization that it's like, because I grew up in, like, the more evangelical branches, it's like we don't refer to the apostles as saints, we just called them the apostles, but it's like, I'm kind of realizing, wait a minute, I mean, it's kind of the same thing with the serial numbers filed off. Although, admittedly, saint does sound a lot more important than apostle.
Yeah, you gotta keep in mind, these were the early heads of the church.
Right.
And effectively, in many ways, the priesthood that the church has established, we didn't sort of invent it per se. Like many of the sacraments that we have, many of the practices that we have, many traditions that we have, it all came from Christ. He started all of that. We simply are participants in that. Now, we don't know exactly why things are set up in the way that they are, but what we do know is that they were given by God. And because of that, we trust in him and that this is the way he wants to be worshipped, how he wants us to worship him, how he wants things to be done. And as Christians, it is our call to answer that and to perform those roles to the best of our ability.
Very true. Very true.
All right, now I'm going to go through how the three different categories differ slightly, starting with the bishop. So the bishop receives the fullness of the sacrament of holy orders, which integrates him into the Episcopal College and makes him the visible head of the particular church entrusted to him. As successors of the apostles and members of the college, the bishops share in the apostolic responsibility and mission of the whole church under the authority of the Pope, successor of St. Peter. Now, in layman's terms, the Pope is essentially the head bishop. He's like the bishop of bishops. So, like, if you look at the hierarchy of the church, you know, of course, it starts with the Pope, then you get the cardinals, the archbishops, and eventually you get the bishops. But, like, the other levels above bishop, I believe, are just higher, like, levels of that, but their roles are very similar to that bishop, just on a it's just a bigger scope, essentially. They cover more people,
right? Basically.
All right, now to go through the priests. Priests are united with the bishops in a sacerdotal dignity and at the same time depend on them in the exercise of their pastoral functions. They are called to be the bishop's prudent co-workers. They form around their bishops the presbyterium, which bears responsibility with him for the particular church. They receive from the bishop the charge of a parish community or a determinate ecclesial office. So think of the bishop as like the head of like a church that controls a region of churches, whereas the priest is more so the head of a specific church in a specific community. So almost like a direct sub-level type thing.
Ah.
Yeah, that's the difference there. The responsibilities are, of course, very similar. It's just kind of like the bishops and the others. The bishops is watch over more people, their heads over more people, so that's where that role kind of comes in. And then finally, we got the deacons, and the deacons are ministers ordained for tasks of service of the church. They do not receive the ministerial priesthood, but ordination confers on them important functions in the ministry of the word, divine worship, pastoral governance, and the service of charity, tasks which they must carry out under the pastoral authority of their bishop. So, deacons basically are the ones that help out with the priest during the Mass. In fact, one of their core responsibilities includes handing out communion during Mass, and they're also the ones who read the Gospels when we do the Gospel reading.
Interesting.
And usually, yeah, it's actually a special role reserved for deacons. A priest wouldn't do that unless they're like, either the deacon was out or there wasn't a deacon. So, there's that right there. Actually, remember earlier when I mentioned how, wait, no. I'll get to that in just a minute. There's a couple notes I want to go over first before I get to there. Here we go. The sacrament of holy orders is conferred by the laying on of hands, followed by a solemn prayer of consecration, asking God to grant the ordination of graces of the Holy Spirit required for his ministry. Ordination imprints an indelible sacramental character. What that basically... I know that sounds like a word. What that basically means is that once you become a priest, you're always a priest. From that point forward until the end of your days. Even if something were to happen where you were basically kicked, not you know, per se, but you were exiled and you were no longer allowed to serve in a church, you still had that marking of being a ministerial priest. That's with you till the end of your days. And whatever happens, that will be reflected upon on Judgment Day, the last day.
Interesting. I would have thought... That's interesting to wrangle my brain around, because, you know, the idea of once a priest, always a priest, but then you can also get... You can screw up so badly that you get excommunicated. It's like... I mean, it makes sense. It's just interesting conceptually.
Yeah, because that's part of the reason why, you know... Oh, and this ties to my next one. So, the Church confers the Sacrament of Holy Orders only on baptized men whose suitability for the exercise of the ministry has been duly recognized. Church authority alone has the responsibility and right to call someone to receive the Sacrament of Holy Orders. So, there's kind of a twofold step to this matter. So, the first thing is there has to be an individual call on the person to be a priest, either from directly from God himself or something within the Holy Spirit that's prompting him to take on this sacrament, to take on this role. And then on the other hand, we also have the Church, which, through a discernment process, determines whether or not that person should become a priest. Because there's, in addition to, like, the desire to become a priest, there's other factors that play a role. And depending on that, that can determine whether or not they will allow you to go through the process in order to achieve the Sacrament of Holy Orders.
Wow.
Yeah, certainly. And the Church is basically making sure that whoever is wanting to become a priest is one who's actually ready for the role and one who's going to take it as seriously as possible. Because this is a huge
deal. Yeah, it makes sense. It's a huge deal. There is a reason that I don't refer to myself as a pastor or a priest, despite doing this here with you, and that's that I consider myself lacking the discipline to, you know, take on that role in any official capacity.
Yeah, it's more than just reading the Bible, like, once a week. There's a lot of stuff involved, especially in the Catholic Church. There's a lot of responsibilities for the priests and the bishops. Because, like, the idea here is that, remember earlier when I referenced how, like, the older, in the pre-Exodus days, the father was, like, the priest of the family? The idea here is that, that basically when you're a priest, or a bishop in this case, you are a father to that community. That's why I refer to our priests or bishops as father, because they're not like a biological father, obviously, but they are a spiritual father in the sense that they are the spiritual head of that church, of that community. They are the leader that helps to aid the people asking the priest in the role of serving the Lord. Because remember, at the end of the day, the ministerial priesthood, their number one job is to serve the kingdom priesthood so that they can draw closer to God and do right by him.
Yeah.
And I also want to share some of the prayers, just two in particular, one for the bishop, one for the priest. So this happens when, like, the bishop would lay their hands on the person and confer onto them the degrees of holy orders, whether it be deacon, priest, or also bishop. So bishops can confer other bishops with the holy order. So the one for the bishop goes something like this. Father, you know all hearts. You have chosen your servant for the office of bishop. May he be a shepherd to your holy flock and a high priest blameless in your sight, ministering to you night and day. May he always gain the blessing of your favor and offer the gifts of your holy church. Through the Spirit who gives the grace of high priesthood, grant him the power to forgive sins as you have commanded, to assign ministries as you have decreed, and to loose from every bond by the authority which you have gave to your apostles. May he be pleasing to you by his gentleness and purity of heart, presenting a fragrant offering to you, through Jesus Christ, your Son.
That's a beautiful prayer right there.
Yep, and also one for the priest as well. So, in this case, this is for a priest. So the bishop has her hand, and he says this, for example. Lord, fill with the gift of the Holy Spirit him whom you have designed to raise to the rank of the priesthood, that he may be worthy to stand without reproach before your altar, to proclaim the gospel of your kingdom, to fulfill the ministry of your word of truth, to offer you spiritual gifts and sacrifices, to renew your people by the bath of rebirth, so that he may go out to meet our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, your only Son, on the day of his second coming, and may receive from your vast goodness the recompense for a faithful administration of his order.
That's awesome.
Yeah, they're really, really good. I love them. And, alright, there's just... Oh, I got one more little tidbit here. In the Latin Church, the sacrament of holy orders, heard of presbytery, is normally conferred only on candidates who are ready to embrace celibacy freely and who publicly manifest their intention of staying celibate for the love of God's kingdom and the service of men. Now, I know some people might be wondering, well, why is it that in the Catholic Church, priests can't get married? Well, there's a bit of a thing to there. So, on the surface level, the idea here is that the Catechism actually quotes St. Paul from 1 Corinthians, where it talks about how they remain celibate for the sake of the kingdom of heaven, and how they have to consecrate themselves to undivided hearts to the Lord and to the affairs of the Lord. They give themselves entirely to God and to men. So the idea here is that by taking on this ministerial role, you want to avoid any attachments that can cause you to, I guess, be biased towards a certain direction, because it's kind of, in my research in hindsight, it's kind of similar to how the Jedi Order operates. In a sense that, like,
you know, my brain went there, but I was hesitating to make that comment because I'm like, no, Seth, stay on track.
No. It's not that bad. It's similar. Obviously, you know, Jedi are not, like, Christians in a traditional sense, but the idea here is that it's very similar in the sense that, like, you are called to serve everyone. Because of that, the church tries to refrain people from having, like, attachments to, like, specific people, because without those attachments, it'll be easier for them to love everyone, to serve everyone the way that God has called them to serve. And that's a very, very important role of the priest. Now, there are some wiggle rooms regarding your sex in that regard. For example, if you're a deacon, you actually can get married. And in the Eastern Rite, there are actually priests, and this is the Orthodox Church, there are priests who have been married before they got, but the kicker is, the people who, what this happened to, they were married before they received the sacrament of holy orders. And in fact, what that means is, once you receive the sacrament of holy orders, you actually cannot marry. You essentially forfeit your right to marriage. In fact, if you were married, your spouse died, and you got holy orders, you became a deacon or a priest, you cannot remarry. You have to essentially remain single and celibate the rest of your days. But like, I know that might sound kind of scary to some people, but at the same time, the people who are doing this, more often than not, they are choosing to be celibate. They are choosing this path. This isn't forced upon them.
Right. And, you know, more power to those people.
Yeah, and I think that's where the confusion goes. It's like, oh, why are you forcing them to not marry? And it goes, no, you're getting it all wrong. They chose not to marry. They knew that, like, they wouldn't be able to do these things being a priest, but they did it anyways because they loved the Lord so much that they wanted to fulfill this role in this capacity. They felt called to this. The church allowed them to go through this process, and now they're here.
This actually ties into something that I learned this week. Did you know that in the Presbyterian branch, being married is actually part a requirement for becoming a priest?
Really?
Yeah. It's not optional.
That is so interesting.
And what, I'm trying to remember the reason behind this, because I watched the video on, like, Monday, and it was something done by Redeemed Zoomer, and that wasn't even the main topic of the video. That was just a side tangent he went on about. But if I remember correctly, there is experience in marriage that is applicable to being an effective priest, not just dealing with hardship in relationships, but there's other aspects of it as well, and that's why it's considered a requirement in the Presbyterian branch to become a priest, is to be married. I don't remember if having kids is part of the requirements, but it is encouraged. I do know that as well.
Interesting. Yeah, that's definitely one of the areas where I think the branches kind of differ in terms, not so much in like having a priest or a pastor, but more so in how they conduct their personal lives on that perspective. I think there might be some differentiations over there.
And but as I mentioned, seeing how successful both the Presbyterians and how the Catholic Church is, I don't think there's really a wrong answer. I think there's just different answers, and with those different answers come different reasons.
And of course, different interpretations of the scripture regarding the role of the priests and how they should get their personal lives versus how they should run their ministries.
Yeah.
But, yeah, that's basically it. The only other thing I'll say is that I remember an episode of the Catechism podcast where Father Mike Schmitz got to the part about, like, who can receive the sacrament, and he basically went on this, like, 15-minute mini speech on why women can't be priests. And basically what it boils down to is also what I mentioned earlier and how the priesthood was rooted in fatherhood, going back to like pre-Exodus, in the sense that, like, you know, we don't know why God said it this way or why he chose only men, because as we know in the Gospels, he actually treated women and children much better than most people in his day. Yet, at the same time, when it came to his apostles and what they did with their successors, it was exclusively men. Now, we're not sure why God did it, but because he did it this way, that is how we are called to set that up. And I think with the way that churches that have female priesthoods are set up, I've seen a lot of examples of them just really deviating in many ways. One of the most infamous examples was actually the one where that woman took a bunch of purity rings and created a vagina idol, and then he worshipped it in the bed.
Yeah, I know the thing you're talking about. I remember seeing that headline, and I'm like, "You people are still doing this? I thought we stopped doing like actual melting down gold and making idols once we got out of the Bronze Age. Evidently not.
You know, it's funny, because people always say, they're like, oh, we don't have physical idols anymore. That's the thing of the past. And I see stories like that, I go, well, some people apparently still do it.
Evidently so, yeah.
Yeah. And then there was another example where, like, I don't know what church this was, but there was, like, a female priest, and she did a weird version of, like, the Our Father prayer, where she referred to God with they, them pronouns.
Oh, and it was just... yeah. That was, if I had to guess, probably some Episcopalian church.
Seems like it, because it looked very formal wear, too, so I'm like, oh. I know it's not Catholic, because obviously it's a woman priest, but something that's at least surface level similar to it.
Yeah, and you know, this whole thing about women not being able to be priests, that's not to say they don't have their own role in ministry. Women can be excellent teachers and theologians. It's just that being a priest is a role that must be undergone by men. Now, I will say this, though. I think that a woman who has a more biblical take on sacraments and more accurate interpretation of scripture is, in some sense, more a priest than a man who has a uninformed view of scripture or an errant view of the sacraments.
Yeah, in regards to the Catholic Church, in addition to like the priesthood that we also have a sisterhood. We have the nuns, we have the big sisters, and they serve a lot in terms of education, helping their communities and stuff. And Father Mike Schultz has shared a story about the origins of his hometown in Minnesota, how the men came over and provided work, and this is they worked in the coal mines and the factories that provided jobs for the communities, but the women were responsible for education and healthcare, and they're the ones that not only made it a home, but turned it into a community where people actually stayed, lived, developed families, and it was through that important role that town grew from a small little mining village to, I think, one of the biggest towns in the state of Minnesota. But wow. It really goes to show, again, you know, I think Father Mike should have said this many times in the past. Men and women are equal in value, dignity, value, and they're equal in the eyes of God. They are both made in the image and likeness of God, and they are both valued as such. However, they are not the same. And because they are not the same, you can't just put a man in a woman's role, expect them to do exactly the same way, and vice versa, because of those innate differences, both biological, mental, emotional. There's a lot of factors involved in there. Men and women are just better at different things. That doesn't make one better than the other, but in the sense that they are complementary. They're meant to work together.
Exactly.
That is why it is often said that a man will leave his mother and father and cling to his wife. They shall become one flesh. I mean, that's all. That's quoting like the last sentence of Genesis 2. From the very beginning, that's how things were said.
Yep. And you know, we've seen the consequences of rejecting that idea, as our society has drifted further and further away from it. you know, we've gone from men and women are different but equal in the eyes of God and the eyes of the law to we are struggling to define what makes a man man and what makes a woman, and everyone is suffering because of it. When you deny objective reality, you will only cause harm to yourself and those around you.
Yeah, absolutely. I think a lot of this kind of stems from like, oh, it's unfair. Why do the men have to do this but women can't do that? I think it's a very basic type thing. But I think a lot of it also stems from confusion, since that, like, you know, just because a man does one thing, that doesn't mean that, like, you're lesser because of that. And I think it's important to make that clear. Men and women have roles to play in our culture and our society. I think it's important to just make that clear.
Right. And, you know, I'm going to do it. My mom, she wanted to be a pastor, I suspect. When she heard about the support you and me were getting, especially when I told her about that, about Murica reaching out to us in the chat saying whether to an audience of 1 or 1,000 you guys are doing God's work, she got incredibly salty and said that she wished women had that kind of support. I said nothing. But in the back of my mind, I'm like, well, you know, there is a reason that women can't be pastors. Even if there's parts of scriptures that I will acknowledge as legitimate, even though I don't agree with them. And it's not always easy to reconcile, but as I've gotten older, I've seen that while I don't always agree, even things I don't agree with in the Bible are usually there for a reason.
You know, there's an old saying that someone goes around where it's like, you know, the Bible says something, your opinion doesn't really matter all that much.
Yeah, and I'm gonna circle back around to that. My mom, when she was in graduate school, she went through seminary courses. She took some heavy-duty theology classes. I actually have one of the textbooks as an audiobook on my phone. I made the mistake of trying to go right from C.S. Lewis to that, and I'm like, oh, I'm in over my head. Okay. But Mom was... a lot of the students at that university were not happy about the seminary classes opening up to female students. There were apparently hate crimes. I say apparently because I have no proof of this. I only have what was told to me by my mom, and thankfully she was never the victim of any such thing. I never witnessed or heard of anything happening there when I lived there and she was going through grad school. But one day she was approached by one of her classmates, and they got to talking, and I can't remember the details, but essentially he said to her, oh, that sounds like a calling. Maybe you should go into children's ministry. And Mom felt incredibly insulted by that. And, you know, condescension is not exactly something that looks good on anyone. And nobody likes being condescended to. But I'm gonna go further on this. When I was a dipshit teenager, newly minted adult, fresh out of high school, I wanted to become a police officer. I was stubborn as a mule about that. And eventually, Mom found my dream to be, like, unrealistic and borderline delusional. One day, she just chewed me the fuck out and said, if you mention being a cop one more time, I am kicking you out of this house. I had my dream crushed that day. But it was ultimately necessary. Now, I still went on to go and work in private security, and Mom denies that she said I would never make it in that field. And granted, it wasn't the right fit for me long term, but it was my first stable job, and I was good at it for the when I was working in it. But it wasn't my ultimate calling. Sometimes the things we want to do are not the things we're called to do, and it's not fair. In fact, it fucking hurts sometimes, And I know some of you watching us might take issue with me swearing, but I want to get across to you the gravity of this and make it clear. Just because you have one plan in mind for your mission and how you think you should serve God, that doesn't mean it's necessarily the right, it's not the right, it's even the right calling for you. You might be called to something you have no desire to do, but if that's what you've been called to by God, to continue pursuing your own path is foolish at best and a form of betrayal at worst. And that's not something that you're going to want to hear me say, but, you know.
And that could literally be anything, by the way. It could be whether to, you know, the priesthood, like I mentioned earlier. It could be to marriage. It could be to celibacy. It could be to some particular role or job as a layman that ordained priests can't do. Mm-hmm. Whatever that calling is, that's what you should strive to do. Because if you truly love the Lord and you want to do right by Him, you should listen to Him when He speaks to you. Because if He's telling you something, first of all, it's because He loves you. And second of all, it's because that is the path that He knows you will best glorify Him by walking the steps. And this reminds me of a passage in the Bible where it is said, a man may make all his plans, but the Lord plants his steps.
Yeah.
What that means is you can plan things all you want, but ultimately, whether you willingly cooperate or otherwise, God is going to lead you towards where you're supposed to go.
Very true. You can't outrun God. You can't hide from Him. I mean, Jonah tried that. It didn't work. You're not going to get very far.
Now, granted, you're not going to get eaten by a giant fish the way Jonah did, but when you try relentlessly to pursue something God does not want you to go, He's going to put, like, steps in your path to try and lead you away from there. And I think at that point, you can see that it's going to be to your own detriment. Right. And that's why it's important to always seek the Lord's guidance and His wisdom before really making any crucial decisions. That's something I try to do in my personal life, whether it's just stuff exclusively to the church or just something that's outside of it, but I'm unsure about. I always try to reach out as often as I can, and I just, whatever God tells me, that is precisely what I do. Nothing more, nothing less.
It's interesting that you bring that up, too, because I was, I nearly brought something to talk about today that it wasn't the right time, just on sheer impulse, and when I decided to pray right before we went live, and God had said to me, it's good that you sought me for guidance before, instead of simply acting on that impulse.
I get where you're coming from.
Yeah. But you know, just final thoughts on what I'd been talking about. There's oftentimes we have to look at ourselves in the mirror long and hard and ask ourselves, am I doing what I want to do, or am I doing what I should be doing? And that doesn't just apply to our spiritual life. That applies to a lot of just day-to-day stuff as well. I mean, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with having the occasional lazy day where you just slack off and do whatever. But, you know, a lot of people our age, and I know this because I have a few friends that I still hang out with, there is a severe lack of self-discipline among our generation. Some people find structure in more secular settings. Some people find structure in the church. And, you know, maybe there are some people who... I'm not a full-blown Calvinist, and I don't, and unfortunately, the Lutheran church I attend does believe in predestination. I don't know if I believe in that or not, but I will say this. Some people are more receptive to correction than others, and I only wish that when I was younger, I wish I could sit down with my younger self, be like, look, here's what's going to happen if you keep doing this. Here's what's going to happen if you pursue the alternative. Because Lord knows, I wouldn't have listened to my... I didn't listen to Mom at the time. I was a stubborn idiot. And, you know, I could have saved myself a lot of headache had I just listened to her.
Well, you know the old saying, sometimes mothers know best.
Sometimes. You know, I really wanted to work in the title for our video today, In God We Trust, because... well, screw it. I'll just retitle the stream after we close. Honestly, this has been all over the place.
Yeah, we're going from holy orders to, I guess, whatever you were trying to make on female priest.
I mean, it wasn't even just that. It was more a matter of... It's a reminder to reflect on one's actions.
Yeah, that's very true. It's interesting because I was reading in the Bible, so I've read the books of Isaiah and Ezekiel, and one of the things that came up was the idea that, like, what you mentioned earlier, in the sense that, are you walking the path that God's called you? Are you doing what God's asked you to do? Or are you just doing whatever you want? And I think as a Christian, it's always good to take some time during your day to just reflect on your actions throughout the day and see where you're going. If you're doing good, that's great. Keep on going. But if you're not, if you're deviating, look back and see what you can do to make that better. Because the good thing about God is that he's always willing to give us a chance to redeem ourselves, no matter how many times we screw up. So long as we strive to keep going after him in spite of our screw-ups.
Amen. And, you know, I don't know if this is true, but I've heard that the word prayer and the word reflect actually stem from the same root word, believe it or not.
Oh, do they now? And which language are we referring to?
I believe Hebrew. Like old school Hebrew from around the time the Bible was being written. Like I said, I don't know if it's true, but it's an interesting bit of trivia that I've heard from my dad.
I just find it interesting you mentioned that, because one of the most common things I do in prayer is just reflect on my day. Reflect on how things went. I talk to God about how things are going, not just with our journey here at Branch Brothers, our streaming careers, but also in regards to work, family, potential relationships, maybe romantic times, things along those lines. It's a lot different things, but like essentially I'm reflecting on all that as I go about my day and just sharing everything with him. Now granted, he doesn't know everything, so he probably knows that anyways, but it's always good to just talk with him about it, just to let him know that I trust him in all things and that I seek his guidance and I want to do right by him.
Yeah,
because that is something I strive to do in my daily life, but especially now since you and I have started this show together.
Yeah, it's funny. I don't really pray about things going well. More often when I pray, I find myself just thanking God for everything he has done for me. There've actually been times where I've been like, I've tried to thank God for literally everything I could think of, and I'm just like, this is so encompassing, I'm just going to say Our Father.
That's okay. I mean, to be fair, everything is a gift from the Lord. But I know it's common for people to just talk about what went wrong or the mistakes that they made so you can forgive the stare, which is important, and you should do that. But yeah. I think it's also equally as important to talk about what went well, because I think one of the goals in your relationship with God is just to be honest with him about how things are. If you're in a bad mood, you're struggling, let him know, and he can guide you. But if things are going well, if they are going good, there's nothing wrong with sharing that with him. There's nothing wrong with doing that. Because at the end of the day, it is a relationship. And this prayer is a lot like a conversation. You shouldn't see it's just like, oh, here's a list of stuff I want you to do by like the next 2-3 weeks. No, it's more like, oh, it's just a conversation. It's like with you and me, right? How we're having this conversation, we're talking back and forth. It's the same way with God.
Right.
Because ultimately, that is one of the many things he desires from us.
Yeah.
And he wants to do.
And any Christian, no matter which branch they fall under, any legitimate Christian will tell you that prayer usually starts as a form of like devotional, and will often evolve into you conversing with God as you continue to grow with him.
Yeah, and the good thing is God always starts from, like, wherever you are. Whatever you are at that point, he will start there, and you just work up from there.
Yeah. We have hit the 50-minute mark. Do you want to roll into worship now?
Oh, absolutely. I think we covered basically everything we needed to say. So, let's do this.
All right. Pull up the display. And... okay, hopefully this time around we don't scuff the lyrics like we did last weekend. Let me get the folder up real quick. Documents, worship songs. Let's do Earthen Vessels to start. Where did I put it? Yeah, here we go. And then let's get the display up. I need to clean up the media sources at some point. Start from first slide. Tab out. Nope, that's not the right one. That's not it either. Why is it not showing up? There we go. Sorry about that, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, I just realized the audio is not playing for you guys. Which is weird, because I would have sworn that I set that up. Oh, here's why. Okay, I don't know why I did that.
We hold a treasure not made of gold in earthen vessels, wealth untold. One treasure only. Shone in our darkness, God has shone in our hearts with the light of the glory of Jesus the Lord. We hold a treasure not made of gold, in earthen vessels, wealth untold. One treasure only, the Lord, the Christ, in earthen vessels.
right, that was Earthen Vessels. And now we move on to our second song. Let's do... Actually, I think we did that one last week. Let's do One Bread, One Body. Start from first slide. Oh, it's captured the frickin' wrong window again. I don't know what the heck happened to OBS to where it's capturing the wrong display. It didn't used to do that. There we go. Open song with media player.
One bread, one body. Throughout the earth. green for the fields, scattered and grown, gathered to one for all. One bread, one body, one Lord of all, one cup of blessing which we bless, and we, though many, throughout the earth, we are
one bread, one body. Let's move on to our third song for worship. This is let's do Grace Flood, I think. Oh, yep, it captured the wrong display again. No. That's not it either. There we go. So what's wrong? Why are you troubled here within me? Deep inside my heart, my soul, what's wrong? So my God, I do not see why you forgive me. Do you need me? Am I wise? Am I strong? So wise, so wise, so wise, so wise. Why do you love me? Why do you care? Why should you think of me? Oh my God, I'll never know. It's unconditional love, unconditional love, unconditional love. The grace flood, unconditional love, unconditional love, unconditional love. The grace flood. Take my hand and lead me further up within here, deep inside your heart, within your soul. On my knees, as I crawl steady up the incline, the glory of your face and I can't stand. So why, so why, so why? Why should you think of me? Oh my God, I'll never know. It's unconditional love, unconditional love, unconditional love.
unconditional love, unconditional love, the grace flows. Why do you love me? Why do you care? Why should you think of me? Oh my God, I'll never know. It's unconditional love, unconditional love, unconditional love. The grace flood, unconditional love, unconditional love, unconditional love. The grace flood.
All right, that was Grace Flood by Orange County Supertones. Let's move into our fourth song. We will do Louder Than the Mob. Open with... yeah, here we go. PowerPoint. And did it capture the wrong thing again? Yeah. Yeah, it did. Okay, no. There we go. I'm getting the handle on it. Start song with media player.
I know I'm just another Judas. Kiss your face while I drive the nail in your hands. I know I'm just another Thomas. Won't believe until I feel the hole in your hand. Then I will say, my God, I see now what you see. My God, what do you see in me? My God, crowned in glory, the Lamb of God is worthy. My sin yelled crucify, louder than the mob that day. My sin yelled crucify, louder than any mouth. My sin yelled crucify, louder than the mob that day. My sin yelled crucify, 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 ay, ay, ay. I'm just another Judas. Kiss your face while I drive the nail in your hands. I know I'm just another Thomas. Won't believe until I feel the hole in your hand. Then I will say, my God, I see not what you see. My God, what do you see in me? My God, crowned in glory, the Lamb of God is worthy. My sin yelled crucify, louder than the mob that day. My sin yelled crucify, louder than any mouth. My sin yelled crucify, louder than the mob that day. My sin yelled crucify. Crucify, crucify, ay, 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 ay. I will say, my God, I see not what you see. My God, what do you see in me? My God, crowned in glory, the Lamb of God is worthy. My God, crowned in glory, the Lamb of God is worthy. worthy. My sin yelled crucify, louder than the mob that day. My sin yelled crucify, louder than any mouth. My sin yelled crucify, louder than the mob that day. My sin yelled crucify, 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 ay, ay, ay.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, this brings us to the end of worship. I'm going to close us with prayer, and I hope that you all have a blessed day. Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our transgressions as we forgive those who transgress against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power, and the kingdom, and the glory, always and forever. Holy Father, thank you for another wonderful day to share your word with those around us. Thank you for our brothers and sisters around the world, not just here with us, but on their own walks with you, O Lord. Continue to guide us and grant us wisdom necessary, that we may serve you faithfully until the end of our days here on earth. In your holy name I pray. Amen.